जी बिस्मिल्लाहिर्रहमानिर्रहीम, अल्लाह के पाक नाम से हम आज की एक इंटरव्यू का आगाज़ करते हैं। फर्स्ट ऑफ ऑल, दिस इज़ द वेंचर ऑफ द सीईओ ऑफ पाकिस्तान एंड मैनेजमेंट हाउस, एंड वी आर स्पेशल एक्सक्लूसिव कन्वर्सेशन विद वन एंड ओनली मिस अंदलीब अब्बास। शी इज़ द पार्लियामेंट्री सेक्रेटरी ऑफ द फॉरन ऑफिस, एंड स्पेशली शी इज़ आल्सो अ गुरु ट्रेनर, राइटर एंड कोच एंड वट नॉट। शी हैज़ ट्रेन मोर देन hundreds of corporate leaders and CEOs. Now she has assumed the office in the new government. Welcome to Ms. Andleeb Abbas. Thank you very much for giving the time. My first question, Andleeb, just share with us your current portfolio. You have been assigned by the Honorable Prime Minister Imran Khan.
Thank you very much, Ijaz. It's always a pleasure to be interacting with you people. And my current portfolio, I am a member National Assembly in the current government. I am also the, where you're sitting is the Ministry of Foreign Affairs. So I am the Parliamentary Secretary for Ministry of Foreign Affairs. And I represent the Ministry in the Parliament. And also I look after the Ministry of Foreign Affairs. And what are the new initiatives of change that we can introduce in the field of diplomacy. So that's my role, to bridge the gap between the parliament and the foreign office, and then the foreign ministry and the international environment.
Well, that's what it means. You are the face of Pakistan. Shah Mahmood Qureshi and you guys are the team.
Yes, Shah Mahmood Qureshi is the foreign minister, and I am basically what we say the balancing face of having somebody as experienced as him and having somebody with the change ideas over here in the ministry and in the parliament as well.
Andleeb, my first question, especially in this conversation, Pakistan. And Pakistan is passing through very testing and difficult times, especially economically and administratively. What is your take on Pakistan's biggest three, four, five challenges which the new government, especially the Honorable Prime Minister IK, is focusing? And what is the success till the 10th months of this passing of this government?
It's a very good question. Three, I would say the biggest challenges are, one, of course, the economic stability.
Yeah.
We got the economy in ICU, as you know. It was hemorrhaging, bleeding. We were in a debt trap. We still are. And so for this economy to become stabilized, and I think this is what we did, that when we were here, we were defaulting, and a default and a bankruptcy, as the corporate leaders know, means the end. So we were not being able to pay off our debts for quite some time. There were delays in that. So our first task was to stabilize the economy, and shukr Allah Ta'ala ka ke we've been able to do that. Our economy is now no longer in the danger of a debt default. Having said that, an economy which comes out of ICU, a person coming out of ICU, you can't expect him to go on and go into the marathon and start running and go in the gym and start doing your push-ups. You have to go in a rehab. So we are going in a revival stage. First was survival, stage number one. We've done that. Now we are trying to go into the revival stage. So the three stages that we have in the corporate sector: survival, revival, and then inshallah sustainable. These are the three stages.
I get fourth one, thriving.
Inshallah. Yeah,
sustain and then thrive.
Thrive, inshallah, we will do that. So we are basically at the moment in the revival stage. We've successfully in the 10 months negotiated the survival, and now we are reviving. Now what happens is that when you are so sick, as the economy was very sick, it was in ICU, and you're going into the rehab, there are a lot of surgeries that you need to do to make sure that you survive. So the second biggest challenge, the first was economic survival. The second biggest challenge is making people do what they don't want to do, which is basically handling reforms, institutional reforms. In the last 70 years, institutional reforms have not been done. That is why you are where you are. As you know, in the corporate sector, what do? We come into a company, the company needs a change, it's not doing well. We change its structure, we change its systems, and we bring new people in. But in the government, it is 22 crore people. It is, for example, a PIA which is bred on 71 years of mismanagement. It is an FBR which is bred on corruption. So we are trying to handle these so-called institutions and trying to bring reforms in them, because without the institutions reforming, the country will not reform. And we are facing resistance. And that's our second biggest challenge. The status quo over here don't want to change. All these institutions are branding us as failures, because if we succeed, they fail. And if we have to succeed, the status quo has to fail and reform has to take place. So that's the second challenge.
Institutional. To challenge the status quo.
To challenge the status quo and bring institutional reforms.
Institutional reforms.
So economic survival, institutional reforms, to challenge the status quo. And the third and biggest challenge is to change the mindset of 22 crore people. That's the biggest problem we have. That how do you make people see that short-term results will bring short-term impact? When people demand that, oh, we want to see what you're doing. We can't see money spent on environment will bring a result after 20 years. Money spent on education will bring a result after 10 years, right? So they want to see, and they have been bred on the roads, the rail, you know, the trains, and they have been bred on the visible changes which don't bring long-term results. Education brings results, but it takes time. Environment needs to be tackled because it takes time. So imagine some small thing, I'll just relate. We said that, you know, we are going to put a fine on people not wearing helmets for motorcycles. It was 1,000 rupees, and the public went uproar. Oh, it's not right, you know, so much fine. We don't want to wear it, it's so hot. And we say, look, there's a law, and it's for your safety. Pakistan has the highest motorcycle accidents in the world. And you kill your family's future. No, madam, let's have less. I said, okay, what do you want? Madam, 100 rupees. I said, that's not a fine. That means that you'll just pay off and not wear a helmet. So this mindset is the biggest barrier to progress. So three challenges. One, economic survival. Second, institutional reforms to get the status quo down. Third, the mindset change of the masses.
Now, again, coming to the first part, the economic challenge. Now, everybody's talking about economy. Everybody is a political analyst and the economic analyst. Kisi na baat ho, kisi ko pata bhi nahi fiscal policy, what is a fiscal policy, what is monetary policy, and he's going to be an expert.
Yeah.
My question regarding economic turnaround in economy. Dollars, parity, you know, yesterday, again, the dollar is going, crossing 160. Inflation, electricity, blah, 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 all basic inputs. The cost of doing business and the people's are being feeling suffocated financially, and the government is giving the narrative, okay, it takes time, but people need immediately, because everybody has to take the breads and the butter daily. These are the woes, these are the messes. Macro level, might be you are doing very well. Micro level, when I meet, you meet, very, very, very difficult times. What is your take on, okay, how much longer this time will take, okay, to come out of this difficult testing times, or people will feel easy, comfortable, cost of doing and ease of doing business, especially?
I agree with you, Ajaz. These are really tough times. And there is the dollar price is up, inflation is happening, there is no doubt about that. Interest rates are going up, but you know what, there is no gain without pain. And you can have what I call, we've had a steroid economy. You know, the steroid economy is that we fed it on debt. I think the easiest thing would be for us also to start printing notes and keep on doing that, make more debt. Now, number one, there is no gain without pain. and the pain is there. But what we are trying to do is that the pain should be more on the well-off people, less on the poor people. So what are we doing? Number one, we are, as far as the electricity prices are concerned, 75% people of Pakistan have only 300 units of electricity. For them, we are not increasing prices. Gas, the same.
Gas from 1st July?
Yeah, but not for the masses. The gas prices are going to be increased as your income goes up. Third thing, we are introducing the social network program. 200 billion, never so much money has been given. So we are introducing the health card, which is basically 7,20,000 rupees. We've already done that for KP and it was very successful. We are already introducing it in the underdeveloped areas of Pakistan. So people, main cost for poor people is bijli, gas, education and health. We are subsidizing that, right? But having said that, look at the principles that we follow. When you come into a small company of 500 people, you first of all stop and you say, okay, now we're going to change and we're going to have reviews, right? So you fire people, you hire people, and the company becomes slow. So if you're going in the wrong direction, like we were going, imports were this much, exports were this much, and you needed all those dollars to pay off. So now what we've done is, if you're going in the wrong direction, we have, first of all, you have to brake and stop the car because we were going down the hill, crashing. We've stopped the car, so there are brakes and the economy has slowed down. And now we are going to slowly turn it around and then take the right direction, which is more exports, less imports, so that the dollar comes down. At the moment, it's the other way around. You have to pay off debt servicing, import bills, and your exports are inching up. Exports, now you're talking about how much time will it take. Exports take one and a half year to build up. For example, now we've been given exporters of Faisalabad and incentives. Their factories were closed. They will open the factories, they've started opening. The machinery was sold off and it's in a rusty stage. Orders will start coming in. It will take one and a half year for you to start having exports up. Imports are already down. Already we have reduced the current account deficit by 26% and by 13%. So the direction is okay. It will not take too long, but it will take some time, maybe a year and a half.
Again, a bit tough question. We have been listening to this narrative, Imran Khan, Prime Minister. We have a very best of the best team, economic team, okay? Asad Umar was leading the team. All of a sudden, the team disappeared and the new team came. Where do you think the loophole was with the team or with the system or with the IMF delayed responses? And for so what is your take on this? Because we love IK Imran Khan. And where is that Imran Khan team?
Mm. So
22 years of this struggle, developing this team.
So just, you know, a great leader looks at the situation and makes adjustments. He doesn't get stuck that on his ego and says, okay, these are the people, he served me for 22 years, this is she, this is he, so I've got to take them along. He says, what is my purpose? The purpose is higher than the team. The purpose is higher than the leader. He says, my purpose is better Pakistan. If I have to get whoever, whether he was with me or not with me, because merit is not loyalty.
True.
Merit is performance.
Very true.
So in this situation, when Imran Khan saw, and if you remember, even in cricket he used to do that, he used to pick up people right from wherever he can and put them on the team, and the whole selection team used to criticize him. Which is happening right now in government also. In this situation, he felt that the pure economist was required. Somebody with a pure economic background was required because it was at the moment an economic survival ICU. He felt that he required a specialist over here, like you have a super speciality in medicine for curing specific diseases. So the debt trap that we are in is a specific disease.
Yes.
The Dutch disease in economics, it's known as a Dutch disease, exchange rate. These are diseases which required specialist economist. Ooh. And that is why he has made this change in team. And let me tell you, if he feels that more changes are required, he will do it. Like a leader who keeps his purpose above the loyalties and above his friendships.
Point is taken. Now, the third question is regarding the economic development, the economic challenges and economic growth. Economic growth comes through two things, basically, as per the researcher. The first is export, as you already mentioned. Exports go up and the economy go up. And the second is the FDI, the foreign direct investments and the local investment as well. Unfortunately, 52% investments decreased in a year, financial year. What is your initiative, your government, your especially the ministry, which is because you are the center of the helm of the affairs, because you are the face, you are connecting with the 180 plus countries in the world to brand Pakistan,
right,
to bring investment, because the ambassadors, Atashi is our economic counselor, commercial counselor, they are the marketing managers. Hmm. Whenever I go to the diplomatic enclave and meet with the diplomats, trust me, Andleeb, they are not the ambassador, they are the marketing manager of the countries.
Mm.
But whereas our people, they are officers, they are in their own egos rather than doing the branding of Pakistan, the image building of the Pakistan. So what are the initiatives of bringing investment? Because one, before over to you, the Minister for Investment just resigned last month, Harun Shoaib. It was really breaking my heart because he was the face of bringing investment. You people are endeavoring. So what is your take? What is the roadmap bringing investment, special concrete steps? Over to you.
Okay. So the first thing, let me correct you. When you say investment is down 52%, you comparing the fifth year of PMLN with the first 10 months of PTI. If you compare, you don't compare a 10-over match with a 50-over match. You compare a 10-over with a 10-over of the competitor. So the first 10 months of PMLN and People's Party, and we published those news, the investment in Pakistan is higher than both of them. When we are in the fifth year, then you can come to me and they say, okay, in the fifth year of PMLN, it was this, and in the fifth year of PTI, it is this, number one. Number two, I think the amount of investment interest that Pakistan is receiving, and I'm sitting in the Ministry of Foreign Affairs, and I'm in touch with many countries, is unprecedented. Let me tell you, when I joined this ministry, I walked into this office, you were saying this, I found out that relationship in our neighborhood was zero. As you know, India was branding us as a terrorist. Afghanistan did not want to talk to us.
His president is today
in Pakistan, wanting to talk with us. Iran was with India and completely off us. And our relationship outside, for example, Middle East, which is our friendly countries, UAE had not visited Pakistan for 10 years, were not on talking terms, our senior people. Bangladesh had refused visas to Pakistan. Bangladesh. Saudi Arabia said, so many years ago, I gave you a little bit of gift to the government. I don't want to any longer. So where do you go? In 10 months, this government had an economic ICU crisis, which we have survived. We had a war with India. I'm sitting in this office.
27th February, everybody knows.
There was a war. It was a war.
Actually,
because
war.
They attacked us. And the diplomacy that we did with the international world, with the media, Prime Minister and Pakistan came out winner in that war internationally. Never have you seen in the international media ever all the media saying, hats off to Pakistan. We averted a war. And our image went up as a peace ambassador. So our image is, we are a peaceful, And we are a business growth friendly country. Now, the third part. Qatar has come in, $22 billion investment lined up. Saudi Arabia, $10 billion, as you know. What are they waiting for? They're waiting for the international accreditation. In a debt trap country with mortgaged motorway, PTV, radio, airports, people don't want to invest till international financial institutions guarantee you. Now that IMF is coming, though it's a last resort, we would have liked to avoid it, but it's a last resort. World Bank is coming. Others, the international financial economic survival credibility is there, that we are not going to default. Now the investment will come in. It's just like you're willing, as a bank, willing to lend to a company which has so much debt, you don't want to give more investment over there. You say, okay, I'll wait for 6 months when other people are also investing and it's sort of stable, then I'll invest into it. So that's what's happening. Third part, the embassies. Absolutely right. 71 years, ambassadors, embassies chosen on political basis, non-merit basis, no performance evaluation, absolutely no role definition. And I'm sitting over here again telling you that it's going to take some time because the mindset is the issue. But the change has happened. We've changed the 5-6 major embassies in the world. As you know, US ambassador has been changed, UK ambassador has been changed, Malaysian ambassador has been changed.
He has been appointed as ambassador.
No, not in the embassies.
But at large.
No, that's just an honorary position for investment. That's not.
And this government was criticizing the appointment and
criticizing the appointment in US for disturbing the line of merit, right? Because our diplomats who've spent 30 years, you remove them and I appoint Ejaz Nassar.
He has no single experience.
I can appoint Ejaz Nassar as a voluntary, honorary consulate or something, but I cannot appoint Ejaz Nassar when I have my director general of 25 years of America desk now waiting to become an ambassador.
True.
Right? So,
killing the merit.
Now, for the first time, and that's where I bring my corporate experience, we invited all these major embassies over here for 2-day conference and training, and they told me with their own, said in 30 years that has never happened. And we told them, look, the challenge is not having an embassy and not public relations. The challenge is the mindset. You people are going to be the sellers and marketers for our country. And now, for the first time, if you remember, we had that leadership conference by Nutshell. 60 people were coming from abroad. There was an India-Pakistan war going on.
Yes, very tough.
Yeah, and all of them were withdrawing. And we did a whole exercise, all the embassies, because they were coming from Canada, UK, US. We got our people in, we asked them to contact, all of them came. And all of them said, we have never received service from embassies the way we did.
Lovely.
Our visas were given in no time. We were given total security. So imagine if in the India-Pakistan war, 60 people came in and you were there. You witnessed it. How they were praising Pakistan. So in 10 months, we have done, sitting in this office, what has not been done in 70 years. Having said that, it's a long haul. There are at least 99.99% things still to be done. But we are on the right track. The problem is only if you keep on climbing the tree and you huff and puff and pant and sweat and everything only to reach the tree of the top and find out it's the wrong tree. We are not on the wrong tree. We are on the right tree, but it's going to huff, puff, pant and sweat before we reach the top.
Again, a very important question, very, very simple question. The role of perception, the role of media, changing the perception, because your ministry is very, very, very critical ministry, changing the perception of the globe about Pakistan. And because we are very, when we go outside Pakistan, the way we are treated, you know very well, how our passport given the value. What is special measured by Andleeb, you and your office and especially your ministry, changing the perception especially, and using the media, the print media, the electronic media, the social media? What is your strategy to bring the branding Pakistan globally?
I think that's a very valid question, very crucial question you've asked, and that's the key. Now what we are doing is that we are making a strategic communication strategy. There are three levels to that. Number one is, what do we stand for? What is our brand, what is our brand USP? Malaysia is truly Asia. India is incredible India. What is Pakistan? So we are doing that. Then we have a brand Emerging Pakistan, and we are doing another exercise on developing the USP for Pakistan. So that will come out very soon. And we are using our international offices, and what we've done is that we are going to be creating international lobbies, because the international media, BBC, CNN, all of them, they have lobbies over there working. So you can give an ad in BBC, it won't make a difference. A lot of money will go into it. You'll say Pakistan, the most beautiful sector. But there, the opinion makers over there will not change. They will keep on saying the same thing, sitting in their assemblies, in their Congress, in their press conferences. So what we are doing is, for the first time, and I was in UK last week, and we're starting with the British Parliament, Pakistani MPs. Now there are a lot of Pakistani MPs, member parliaments, who have won the elections.
Fine.
So we are creating a group in UK.
Focus group.
It's a friendship group of changing perception of Pakistan within UK. And we just had a launch over there in the Westminster Parliament. And I was initiating that launch. We showed a video in Pakistan. We called the media. And we are going to be using their parliamentarians to lobby the true face of Pakistan.
Right. That's a good strategy.
Number one. And we have a lot of other strategies which I can't reveal at the moment, because some of the strategies are not to be,
It'll take some time.
So we are going to go in the main think tanks, main parliaments, main influencers over there. For example, we are inviting Australian senators to come and see and go back, because in Australia, we feel that we need to up our potential so that investors from both countries feel comfortable with us. Because when I say something about Pakistan, they say she's biased. But when an Australian senator gets up and says, I've been to Pakistan, this is what I've seen, policies start shifting over there. So that's the second part. The third part is, we are going to be using social media. We've already done. We've called bloggers in. As you see, we had
PD
the Pakistan,
expert in this year.
Pakistan tourism strategy we had. And in that tourism strategy, if you remember, we called in the experts. And those experts then went around, the bloggers, women, they created videos,
and
they have millions of views now.
I was in the Prime Minister's house, and he was last 2 months back.
So we are going to have, we are going to be looking at the political branding, policy branding, then we are going to be looking at country branding, and then we are going to be looking at the individual product branding. So this is all strategic communication, and we have a target of about a 3-year target, in which we reposition Pakistan in a way where the word of mouth starts saying, okay, so you know, Pakistan is a peaceful country, it's a good country to visit, lovely country, and a fruitful investment.
Last time I heard the United Nations statement, Shah Mahmood Qureshi, the Pakistan is the safest country.
Yeah.
Yes.
I'll give you three examples of what we've done in 10 months. 10 months. Number one, 170 countries, visa on arrival.
Yes, the biggest change.
50 countries, visa not allowed at all. NOC not required, because this is what our feedback was from our embassies over here, that why do you require NOC for going to Gilgit-Baltistan? So a lot of spots which were, for the last 20 years, nobody had even thought that they are now safe. Why have you put on NOCs over there? Pakistan is not what Pakistan was 4 years ago.
True.
So we've removed that. Movement is more free. Third, in Europe, Portugal has removed travel advisory from Pakistan totally. UK has partially removed travel advisory in various cities of Pakistan. France, I'm just giving you an example, will do it for a few,
okay.
It'll be announced. UN has declared this as a family station.
Yes.
World Bank is going to, inshallah, also follow suit.
These are the positive.
So this is what we've done in 10 months. And we are doing a lot of other public diplomacy, international public diplomacy things, where you will see a lot of students exchange programs, sports diplomacy, cultural diplomacy.
Religious diplomacy.
We are doing a religious diplomacy on Kartarpur, Sikh diplomacy. We are doing a Buddhist diplomacy. And you'll see a lot of, it'll take about a year. We made us the strategy of Buddhist tourism. And from Sri Lanka, right down to Asian Pacific, all the countries, Buddhist countries, we are preparing a special strategy for them.
I think you're bringing the cricket diplomacy because this is the biggest tour.
Yeah.
Pakistan has not witnessed for the last more than one decade the international cricket in Pakistan.
We are going to have two teams visiting Pakistan, inshallah.
My great years. A few questions then we're going to the end side. Taking the big picture, not coming to the execution part of the strategy, the vision, the planning you shared about this new government. Now, execution part of my question is serious. Ministers, the politicians are sometimes very good people, they want to change, they want to bring change. But the challenge is the red tapeism, the colonial mindset, bureaucracy, the great 20 to 21 officers. These people's they love traditions, they resist change. What is your strategy regarding their mindset change, their KPIs from ACR to KPI? The real HR, we have been talking for the last two decades about the KPI, the job description, right man for the right job. This is the age of artificial intelligence, this is the age of blockchain, and this is the age of. So, in this age, what is your strategy for execution of the big ideas and changing these people, because they are the levers to you have to bring the execution. So what is the strategy bringing the bureaucratic minds and change?
200% I agree. That's the status quo I was talking about, our biggest challenge, mindset change. I talked about it. Okay, so we have a task force which is preparing a civil service reform, and it is the toughest. It is the toughest, I tell you, because these people are, as you very rightly said, trained not to change. I remember that that quotation I used to love, and I'll just share it, that the bureaucrat is a strange missile. It doesn't work and it cannot be fired. So we want accountability and performance. For that we have to change, because what do they do? You fire them, they take a stay. They become OSDs, and they still take money without working.
Or enjoying it.
And so what we are doing is that we are bringing civil service reforms and accountability. We have started with the top. Nowhere in the history of Pakistan would you find a prime minister who comes in the first 8 months, looks at ministers, says, seven of you not up to the mark, out. They may be his best friends.
Very, very, very tough decision.
They may be his best friends. They may be his most loyal people. They may be his most promising people. But if you're not performing, now when he does that at the top, if you remember, that's what Jack Welch did. Jack Welch, first of all, removed five of his vice presidents. Because he said, when I remove them, then when it goes down, it trickles down, then everybody who knows they will not perform, they will know they will not stay. So what is happening is now that we are creating that accountability cycle where these bureaucrats will be, and that's why you people are objecting, why have you changed four IGs in Punjab? And I answered them, I said, look, you talk about performance. If they are not performing, would you keep four vice presidents in a multinational company if they're not performing? No. So why should we keep four IGs if they're not performing? So we are doing those things. The reforms are going to be the toughest, and they're already being resisted, and they're trying to defeat them. That's why it's taking long, but they are going to happen. That's the surgery, which is painful. But without that, I totally agree. All those policies will remain that. And, you know, I can share a few stories, I don't have time, where very resistant bureaucrats have to become malleable because they know that in this government, there is no place to hide.
There is a difference between loyalty and malleability.
Yes. You see, loyalty, family relationship, being there for 20 years is like a government officer. Oh, God, you know, these people come to me and they say, you know, but madam, we have been there for 10 years. We deserve this. And I talked to them. I said, so what have you done for 10 years? Because this guy who's with me has done more in 10 months than you've done for 10 years. And they're shocked. They can't understand. I have to really make them understand.
Short few questions, then we wrap up. Now, Andleeb, just tell me, this government basically when came in, they were talking about education. Because at the end of the day, you told education reaps the results in the long term. But we are seeing this narrative education, emergency rather, and Shafkat Chima Sahab, Shafkat Sahab is leading this ministry. They were talking for the last 10 months or 1 year, we are having the same syllabus. This polarization, this mindset, because it is the basically outcome of the education system. Madrasas, Fauji schools, Army public schools, Cambridges, O level, C level, B level, LAMS or BLA or private education, Sarkari, and there is a total mental divide. When the kid grows up, he says, I am O level, he is a matric, he's just looking at me, he's hated. And this kind of the feeling, the mindset we are nurturing in subconscious programming of our new generations. When will dream will come realize? We have same quality of education for Pakistan. And second, 2.5 crore, I mean 20 million, 25 million out of education. The third is skilled education, right? Purpose-built education, rather not degree for degree 6. And fourth is the investment. Budget education is not a... hum to training, kehte the, training is in, not expense, training is an investment. So education mein budget bhi kam kar diya gaya, ab sari universities are struggling. So these are 3-4 dimensions related to education. Your take.
Again, I'll correct you. Education budget has been increased. What happens? Literacy rate in Pakistan has come down from 60% to 58%. Can you imagine? What were they doing? See, they would come in and they would say, okay, I'm going to have 10,000 billions for education. And there you would see a PSTP document, education budget, that. But they would spend only 40% of it. The rest was all projects which were never initiated. Otherwise, education in Pakistan would have improved. Now, what we've done is that all the wrong figures that they have given, and there are many, even the growth figures are wrong. Every year we know IMF used to say that, you know, it's not 4.5, it's 3.3. Why are you putting your refunds which you have to pay to the exporters as your income? These are payables. So we have to, now we are paying them off. Can you imagine the Prime Minister's house? Last 5 years, electricity expense was not paid. It was shown in the income because it was not paid. We have just paid it yesterday. On the National Assembly, we announced it. That last 5 years, Prime Minister house electricity bill was not paid, 10 crore rupees. We have paid it. So these are the gimmicks they were doing. Education, they would show, okay, this university, this much amount, and they would not give it for 5 years. And every year it will be announced. So what do they say? Say, okay, last year it was 50 billion. Now this year it's only 45 billion. But guys, you put up 50 billion, you only spend 25 billion. So on that 25 billion, we have spent 45 billion. And our 45 billion is 20 billion higher, and we will make sure that it is spent in every area, number one. Number two, absolutely essential, 3 education systems merge. Shafkat Mehmood Saab has already, and it was a very long and difficult process. Getting the mullahs in, getting the madrasas in, buy-in, consultative mode, because we are a democracy. We cannot impose. So getting the public school and all, now the National Literacy Council has made one syllabus. And let me tell you, and let me tell the viewers, this will take time. We have millions of schools with the old system. We will rehire teachers, as we did in KP. It took us 3 years to rehire teachers, retrain them. And in the fifth year, you started seeing results. So it will take 3-4 years. And then maybe we may not be in the government after 5 years, but 10 years later, the child who comes out of that school, whether he's from a madrasa or from a beacon house or from a government secondary school, will be the same.
Okay, thank you very much. Now,
last up.
Dozen questions.
I'm late for this.
I got it. Your recipe of success.
My recipe of success is very simple. One is, and that is in politics and in my life also,
yes,
and everywhere also. See what others can't see, number one. When all is dark,
excellent.
When all is dark, see the light. That is what vision is. If you see what others see, oh, khatam ho gaya, gir gaya, economy ye ho gayi, wo ho gayi, then you like the masses. If you want to be a leader, in the dark cloud, you see a star shining and move towards it. That's the North Star. And the North Star is the principles. Number two, take the unpopular decisions. When you are in trouble, take the hard, unpopular decisions. People will criticize you. People will punch you. But stand for the right, unpopular decision. Eventually, you will win. And third, when the world gives it to you and they're tough on you and circumstances look as if they are going to push you down, knock you down, you have three choices. Give in, give up, give it back. Take the third choice.
Stress. And because is a result of expectations. Because pura Pakistan ki ab Andleeb Abbas ke upar jo sadkon pe maar kha rahi thi, tough times tha, pamphlet baant rahi thi, aur matlab Andleeb Abbas ne dhoop nahi dekhi, barish nahi dekhi, hum dekhte rahe, mashallah Allah ne izzat di, yahan pahunche. Ab itni expectations logon ki, aur phir aapke apni jo hope pe public office job load kiya, stress level high ho jata. What is the coping strategies of Andleeb Abbas? Stress management.
देखिए वो जैसे हम अपने कॉर्पोरेट वर्ल्ड में भी कहते थे कि यू नो स्ट्रेस इज़ आल्सो गुड. स्ट्रेस मोटिवेट्स यू, क्योंकि अगर एक डेड बॉडी होती है जिसमें स्ट्रेस नहीं होता, हरकत वाली बॉडी में तो स्ट्रेस होता है. हाँ, यू हैव टू ड्रॉ अ लाइन बिटवीन प्रेशर एंड टेंशन. सो डोंट लेट द स्ट्रेस बिकम टेंशन, बिकॉज दैट विल पैरालाइज यू. स्ट्रेस एज अ मूवर एंड शेकर इज़ गुड. नाउ हाउ डू यू डू दैट? नंबर वन, always see the positive and see the silver lining, and look at your day and see one small thing that motivates you. Sometimes it's been a bad day in the assembly and everybody is bashing you down and your own party is disagreeing with you, and you walk back in, your shoulders are down, and you meet a security guard downstairs and he says, madam, aapne hamari baat ki na, salute.
Wow.
Your day is made.
Relax.
Your day is made. So you focus on that one small point. Number two, physical fitness. As you know, Ijaz, I am an exercise freak. And every morning, every alternative morning, I do a workout which keeps me going. And number three, spirituality. Start looking above yourself and start looking at a cause higher than yourself. I have come into this office, not for this office. You are a witness that I had a whole life over there in the corporate world.
You are an icon.
But I have come over here because the purpose is higher than me.
Yes.
And when I feel that even for a small segment, for somebody else, I would be able to change their life and make it better, it's all worth it. It keeps me going. The stress becomes less.
What book do you recommend to the people who are listening to you? Kitabein to bahut sari hain, ek do kitabein batayein jo usually transform Andleeb Abbas, ya really people must learn.
मैं दो तीन बता दूंगी. एक तो मेरी जिंदगी चेंज हुई 7 हैबिट्स ऑफ हाईली इफेक्टिव पीपल से, और मेरी जिंदगी चेंज हो गई.
बल्कि तो लोग अब स्टीवन कभी कम जानते हैं.
मेरी जिंदगी चेंज हो गई, और मैंने पता नहीं कितनी दफा पढ़ी है, और हर दफा मुझे कोई नई चीज, आई फाइंड न्यू थिंग्स इन इट. सेकंड इज होस्टेज ऑन द टेबल.
होस्टेज ऑन द टेबल,
हाँ. इट इज वन ऑफ द बेस्ट बुक्स आई हैव रेड ऑन मेंटल साइकोलॉजी एंड हाउ डू यू नेगोशिएट your life and your profession in tough situations.
Okay.
Right? Number 3, Bange Dara.
Aye, Iqbal.
Maine Shikwa Jawab Shikwa se jo sikha hai,
ultimately se
kisi aur se nahi sikha.
Ho nahi sakta. Difficult decision, one difficult life ka ya professional journey ka, kyunki decision making ki sari leadership hoti hai.
Coming into politics,
difficult.
Leaving my corporate life,
comfort life, itna mazey ki sab kuch,
and coming into politics, and then every single day hearing it from everybody, everybody in the corporate life, and my family, friends.
ये क्या कर रहे हो?
क्या कर रहे हो? Just to give you a small example, in the end, then we learn. I was going doing campaigning in the elections, NA 125 Nawaz Sharif's constituency with Dr. Yasmin. And in a small gully, I knocked her, and a woman came out, and she said, "Oh, madam, please come in. You've taught my son."
Achha.
So she was very happy. She started giving us tea, etc. And then she said, "Madam, should I ask you a question?" तो मैं थोड़ा सा पंजाबी में बोलूँगी. तो she said, "Madam, एक सवाल पूछा." मैंने कहा, "हाँ पूछो." कहती, "Madam, ਤੁਸੀਂ ਇੰਨਾ ਸੋਹਣਾ ਕੰਮ ਕਰਦੇ ਸੋ ਇੱਕ ਯੱਬ ਵਿੱਚ ਪੈ ਗਏ ਹੋ
ਯੱਬ ਵਿੱਚ ਪੈ ਗਏ
ਸੋ ਸ਼ੀ ਵਾਸ ਸੇਇੰਗ ਦੈਟ ਯੂ ਆਰ ਸੱਚ ਅ ਗ੍ਰੇਟ ਟ੍ਰੇਨਰ ਟੀਚਰ ਯੂ ਆਰ ਗੋਇੰਗ ਫਰੋਮ ਗਲੀ ਟੂ ਗਲੀ ਵਾਟਸ ਰੋਂਗ ਵਿਦ ਯੂ ਬਟ ਇਟਸ ਫਾਰ ਅ ਹਾਇਰ ਕੌਜ਼
ਤੇਰੀ ਬਾਤ ਉਹ ਪਰਪਸ ਆਪੋ ਦਾ ਐਨਰਜੀ ਦਿੰਦਾ
ਹੈ ਦ ਪਰਪਸ ਲਿਫਟਸ ਯੂ
ਇਹ ਬੜਾ ਇੱਕ ਬਾਤੀ ਸਾ ਸਵਾਲ ਹੈ ਜਸਟੀਫਾਈ ਡੂ ਯੂ ਜਸਟੀਫਾਈ ਵਰਕ ਲਾਈਫ ਬੈਲੈਂਸ ਬਿਕੋਜ਼ ਦੇ ਬਹੁਤ ਕੁਰਬਾਨੀਆਂ ਦੇਣੀ ਹੁੰਦੀ
ਨਹੀਂ ਆਪ
ਮੈਂ ਕਰ ਲੈਂਦੇ
ਹਾਂ ਆਈ ਐਮ ਗੁੱਡ ਐਟ ਦੈਟ I make sure because मुझे पता है कि अगर मैंने life balance maintain ना किया तो हर चीज का मजा खत्म हो जाएगा.
क्या फायदा है glory का और ऐसी success?
And we have 24 hours, we can manage.
Your role model?
I have
inspiration.
मेरी जो political role model है वो Dr. Martin Luther King है.
Okay.
I am inspired by him. मेरी जो social activist role model थी वो Dr. Yasmin Rashid थी. She is a great lady. और मेरे जो spiritual role model हैं वो the Prophet peace be upon him. I mean there's nobody greater than him. And basically what I feel is Rumi.
Rumi. आजकल बहुत innovative है. Last question ही women's के ऊपर फिर उसके close कर दीजिएगा. Women empowerment के लिए government क्या कर रही है? Women ministry बना रही है women's? डेवलप करने के लिए या ये भी ये कोई बजवाड़ी है कि वुमेंस के लिए
देखिए हमारा
जेंडर क्लैश होना चाहिए.
नो आई थिंक दिस इज अ मेन थिंग. हमारी जो यू नो हिज आवर प्राइम मिनिस्टर सेज दैट व्हाटएवर आई एम इज बिकॉज ऑफ ही हैज फोर सिस्टर्स एंड मदर एंड व्हाटएवर आई एम इट्स बिकॉज ऑफ माय मदर एंड ऑल दैट एंड इट्स दिस सोसाइटी इज वेरी अनफेयर टू वुमेन. फर्स्ट थिंग दैट वी डिड इफ यू रिमेंबर ह्यूमन राइट्स मिनिस्ट्री. We announced inheritance rights for women.
Okay.
And we passed a bill, first bill we passed, and we have made it mandatory that if women are not given their property rights, we are going to not only confiscate but punish. It's a now a penal criminal punishment. That's something that we are doing. We're also doing, as far as health is concerned, we are going to be the first party, we've already started that, mother child specialist hospitals.
That is a great initiative.
Five, or first one already in Mew Hospital. We are going to have similarly in education. In KP we decided 100 new schools, 70 for women, for girls, 30 for boys. So everywhere we are going to be highly discriminatory but in favor of women.
Your message of hope and optimism for the youth, because youth is the future leaders, the bulge. Because they are jobless. हमारा इस वक्त सबसे बड़ा मसला और आपका बहुत बड़ा नैरेटिव था जॉब्स का, यह आखिरी सवाल है, ये डिफिकल्ट भी है, कहाँ है जॉब्स इन बेचारे यूथ, फ्रस्ट्रेटेड यूथ के लिए, पढ़े लिखे बच्चे जो अनपढ़ों की तो बात ही करते हैं, अनस्किल्ड भी नहीं करते, लेकिन जो पढ़े लिखे हैं उनके लिए भी कुछ भी नहीं
है जी. ये सिंस आई हैव बीन यू नो रिलेटेड विद एजुकेशन इंडस्ट्री ऑल्सो एंड इट इज, लेट मी टेल द यंग पीपल ऑफ दिस कंट्री दैट दिस इज अ टाइम विच लुक्स टफ, बट यू नो समटाइम्स it looks beautiful, and when you poke a finger it all falls down. This was what we had inherited, ke achhi aapko bahar se lepa poti achhi lagti thi aur andar haath lagaya to kuch bhi nahi. Ab hum uski roots sahi kar rahe hain aur roots ke andar achhi education, achhi skill training aur achhi opportunities dal rahe hain. Thoda sa time lagega, but let me tell you, housing is starting, so semi skilled and skilled work, aap 2 mahine mein jobs aana shuru ho jayengi. Skilled ke liye we are preparing our training institutes. 6 months later already we have requirement from Qatar for 100,000 people for FIFA football. We have from Hungary, Bulgaria people, and we are going to be doing mass international employment, but skilled employment. We are going to match the employers with the jobs, and let me tell you, industry is going to be definitely growing after 2 years. And you will have more jobs than you've ever had. Keep at it. इस 2 सालों में घर बैठ के मायूस ना हो और फेसबुक पे अपनी फ्रस्ट्रेशन निकालने के बजाय अपनी स्किल्स इम्प्रूव करें, कोर्सेज और कर लें, अगर बिजनेस किया है तो आईटी कर लें, आईटी किया है तो बिजनेस कर लें. जितने ज़्यादा स्किल्ड होंगे 2 साल बाद आपने ही सारे फ्रूट्स लेने हैं.
इंशाल्लाह. थैंक यू वेरी मच.